Welcome to another Art of Composing Daily Vlog. I'm John Brantingham. I am your host for this, and this is episode number 11. And today we are going to be talking about 5 tips for better sketching. Okay, so my first tip is use paper and pencil. Now, everybody knows that I'm a big fan of doing things traditionally, and I know that a lot of people probably look at that and just think, I'm just going to stick to my DAWs and my sample libraries and everything like that. However, there's a lot of benefit to getting away from those things and going back to paper and pencil. So my thought process is that when you use a DAW or Sibelius or Note Perform or any kind of notation software, Finale, MuseScore, or any other computer program, most of the time you are locking yourself down right from the beginning. Let's say that you're playing around on the piano and you just press the record button and you're starting to work on ideas. Everything is very much set in stone. And I believe during the sketching process that it's actually good to have things a little bit fuzzy. You don't necessarily want to be locked into an idea. And often when I'm playing around at the piano, I maybe play a little melody that I like. Sometimes I won't write it down exactly how I played it the first time. And while a lot of people could look at that and say, oh, you've lost that idea that you had, really what it is you get time to work on it as you're writing it down. You get time to refine it and change it. So the first one, paper and pencil, I love to do that. I just love the flexibility of it. You can make squiggly lines. You can, you can block out things. You can do whatever you want. You can draw. You could do art. It doesn't even matter as long as you know what you're doing. So paper and pencil, definitely a big one. Next, start with constraints. So constraints are things that feel like they're going to make it more difficult for you to get a good idea because you're limiting the possibilities. In reality, the more constraints you have, usually your creativity expands within the space. So it's kind of like building yourself a little room. If your room is a massive hall, right, there's no way you're going to fill it up. It's going to be overwhelming. You're going to probably feel like there's just too much possibility. But if you have a little box, it's very easy to fill up a little box with ideas, with whatever you want. So I like to set just some basic constraints usually, things like time signature, key signature, tempo. Often I'll choose a form beforehand. And remember, this is sketching. This is not necessarily the final version. So a lot of this can change, but just the act of picking it usually frees up some creative space in your mind. Now, there's other things that you can set constraints on, which can be very helpful. For one, setting a time limit during your composing session, I find to be extremely helpful when I'm composing. And I've written plenty of pieces where I've set 30 minutes as the time allotted, and I'm not supposed to go over that. Now, often, I'll continue on with that long beyond that, but just that timer staring you in the face gets you moving along pretty quickly. Things like instrumentation, that's a great thing to set constraints for. I mean, if somebody says write for orchestra, that could mean a million different things, and there's a lot of possibility there. However, if somebody says, I want you to write for harp and piano, violin, viola, cello, and clarinet, well, now your mind starts to open up with possibilities. What kinds of sounds can I create with those instruments? How are those instruments going to blend? How am I going to be able to make, really cool sounding textures that people haven't really thought of, just because that's your limit. You can't, to say, what's it going to sound like to have harp and piano playing together? That's just a cool idea to try to work out some cool techniques, things like that. So constraints, obviously, I love them, and I think you should be using them in your sketching. Tip number 3, make progress, and make progress quickly. So I think that the biggest thing that you can do when you're sketching is not stopping. You just got to keep on going. Probably you've heard of me talk about the problem of noodling if you've ever seen any of my symposiums. We as composers, we love the sound of music. We love kind of just getting into the things that we're doing. I love sitting there and improvising just as much as anybody else. However, it can bite you if you don't actually stop and put down onto paper what you're doing. More often than not, I find that if I don't make a concerted effort to write a bar at a time at least, or maybe, 2 bars, then I'll spend 10 minutes and I won't even realize I haven't written a note of music. And often too, I'll start off with good intentions and I'll be doing a bar and then I'll play, and then I'll do a bar, and then I'll play, do a bar. And then you'll get to a point where you're not quite sure, or maybe you had a good idea and you're just trying to follow it. And that's where it starts to creep in. You just start to play ideas out instead of actually playing it and then writing it down, playing it and then writing it down. So a good exercise for everybody, I think, it's letting go of what the music is, letting go of what it sounds like, play something, and then write it down immediately. Play something, write it down, like one bar at a time, and just forget about what you're writing. Make that the exercise. And then when you actually come to your real sketching sessions, when you're really trying to compose some music, you'll find that you're a little bit faster at it, a little bit quicker, and you get more material down. Tip number four is rewrite as little as possible. So one of the best ways to make forward progress when you're composing is to not do things that are redundant. Now there's a couple things specifically that I like to do. First is if I've got a note or a chord that's repeated, I'll just write the rhythmic value. So for instance, let's say I'm writing a chord and it's repeated eighth notes, right? Ba, 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 something like that. I'll write the chord first and then I'll just put lines and I'll connect them so it looks like eighth notes, but you won't see the heads on all those. That's a really quick way to write a lot of notes and make sure that it's the right rhythm and you know exactly what that means. You know that those are repeated notes. I see this a lot if I'm looking at composer sketches. That's a common technique. Another thing that I don't like to repeat, but I can reference, is complete ideas. So, if you've ever listened to me talk about form, there's something called a basic idea, which is a two-measure idea that allows you, it's kind of like the raw material for a theme. It's usually something that you'll fragment or you'll use as the basis for other ideas within that theme. Often what I'll do is I'll write the first two measures, and then if it's, say, like a sentence and I'm going to repeat it exactly, I'll just give it a letter and a number. So it'll be A1 and 2. And I know this is basic idea A and then measures 1 and 2. And it's a really quick and easy way to reference. And then I've also got a way to modify that. So if I'm doing A1 and that doesn't change, but A2 changes, I'll still label the repetition as A2. But then I'll do like 2.1 or something. That lets me know that it's similar, it's got the same feel, maybe even the beginning of the measure is the same, but then at the point that I start writing notes, that's where it changes. So that's a quick way to repeat material. And you don't just have to stop at ideas, you can do phrases, you can do themes, you can do entire sections, although at that point, there should be enough change between this section to that section that it should probably be an exact repetition. And now my final tip, and I think this is a critical tip for everybody, is you need to make it a habit. So composing music is one of those things that if you don't do a little bit all the time, and it doesn't necessarily have to be every day, but I try to do a little bit every day, and if you don't do a little bit all the time, it's not going to become something that feels natural and easy for you. For me to sit down and write a two-measure basic idea or a four-measure phrase or an eight-measure theme, it's really not that much work. I can usually pump that out pretty quickly. Now, is it always my best work? No, it's not. It's not always going to be good music that you write, and that's something that you just have to get over. Most of the stuff that you write in your entire life is probably not going to be very good. And the evidence is there in a lot of great composers. I mean, obviously, most composers, you don't get to see their early works, their stuff that they were going through school with their teachers, their juvenilia works. But even beyond that, if you look at what's actually performed for famous composers, it's usually not their early stuff. It's usually the later stuff. I mean, everybody knows Beethoven's Symphony No. 9. You know, everybody knows the Gross of, well, not everybody knows the Gross of Fugue. If you're a composer, you should know the Gross of Fugue. You know, everybody knows Mozart, Symphony No. 40. But very few people have actually listened to Mozart's Symphony No. 1 or Beethoven's Symphony No. 1. They're just not nearly as popular, and it's because they're not as refined. They hadn't built up the kind of skill and experience that they had composing their later days. And it's one of those things you just have to accept that a lot of the music that you're going to write is not going to be very good. You have to make it a habit every day to just sit down and write music, though. That's the only way you're going to get better. And definitely you'll get better at sketching if you sit down, write a little bit every day, work on these practical tips that I've given you, and just make your way through a lot of music. So hopefully you enjoyed episode 11 of the Daily Vlog. If you're looking to learn composing, head over to artofcomposing.com and check out. I've got articles, I've got podcasts, I've got videos, I've got a free course, and then I've got two major paid courses. So Composition 101 takes you through all the fundamentals, and Composition 201 takes you through long-term form. So basically I show you how to take the skills you built up in Composition 101 and turn them into something that's a much longer piece, like 4 or 5 minutes, and that's Composition 201. So I will see you next time.